Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. And Father, you hear the cry of every heart. You hear the cry of every mind. And you know, Lord, that there is always a fullness of time. And the fullness of time, O God, has begun in this decade. And Father, what you have designed and in store for this place tonight, for every single one who is here, Lord, ordained and arranged by your angels and by your Spirit, you know every thought. You know every desire. You know every aspiration. You know every dream. You know the desires of each heart here. You know every heartache, every cry. And we ask, O God, that each one here may have an encounter with your Holy Spirit. We ask, O Father, that your Holy Spirit will reveal Himself, to reveal Jesus in our hearts and in our lives. And Father, we ask, O God, that your Holy Spirit, whom you have sent to be with us, whom your word declares, that we shall no more be orphans, because Jesus has gone and has sent His Holy Spirit to be our advocate, our helper, our comforter. Oh, Father, we ask that your Holy Spirit will find a way to reach into every heart and every mind tonight. And whatever way, oh God, or avenue open in every heart and mind, that you will reach right through to your Spirit and reveal the glory of Christ to each one. Oh, Father, open the eyes of your people that they may see your glory. Open the eyes of your people that they may see the presence of Jesus here in our midst. For so many of them have lived by faith. They believe your word. They were two or three are gathered together in your name. There you are in our midst. Open the eyes of their spirit. Grant the discerning of spirits to drop into our hearts and minds, that those who are ready may have their eyes open, that they may see your glory and see Jesus in all the fullness of his glory. Reveal Jesus, that we may see him for all that he is. That we may know, Father, that Jesus is here tonight in this place. He's here, O God, not tomorrow to meet our needs, but tonight we could encounter Him. Tonight we can meet Him face to face. Tonight our hearts can commune with Him. O Father, let your will be done tonight. Reveal yourself. Show your glory to your people, O God. Show your grace and mercy. And Lord, touch the hearts that need to be touched. The minds that need to be touched. The bodies that need to be healed. Oh God, let your will be established and done in this life. For all that you do, we covenant to give you the glory, the praise, and the honor, Lord. To you it all belongs. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God, you may be seated. Amen. As some of you here are new tonight, in this phase, my life has been divided into 10-year periods. And I live, and my wife is here, she can testify to it, I live purely for the ministry of the Lord. And a fire burns in my heart to complete the work that God has commissioned. And my life has been divided into 10-year phase. The first 10 years, 1976 to 1980, 1986, the period of the Word, 1986 to 1996, the period of Spirit, 1996 to 2006, the period of the Blood, and 2006 to 2016 is the period of the glory of the Lord. And in March 2006, as I was completing a 40-day fast, I do that every year, around the time of February, March, the Lord took me into the realm of His Spirit, and He showed me the spiritual world. For every night, the moment I spent a day with God and prayed, and I do all those normal things and responsibilities and spend time with God. But every time I go to rest, in a split second, He takes my spirit out and shows me continuously over a period of many, many weeks. Some of those things I put into a book called The Spiritual World. And among those things that He said are to prepare the body of Christ for that which is to come. Part of the book is also to prepare the people of God for what heaven is going to be. And that we really know the place that is our true home, heaven. And among those things that God has spoken and shown me as He commissioned and sent me back is that there will be two waves of the Spirit in this decade of 2006 to 2016. The first wave will be a wave of healing. It will be the Word and the Spirit working together. But in this wave of healing that's coming forth, it will be so powerful that and affect the body of Christ so that every time we are gathered together, we would expect the blind to see. We would expect the lame to walk. We would expect deaf ears to be opened. We will expect all the things that Jesus do as if it's a normal Christian experience. And the faith of God's people will be risen to that level, and as they operate at that level and becomes so common, if I can use the word, or so normal. What is abnormal is that it's not happening. But it becomes so normal and occurrence that we expect because Jesus is in our midst and He continues to live. He is risen from the dead. And as the people get used to that level, He will release a second wave. And the second wave will be a wave of creative miracles. Where people with amputated limbs will suddenly get a new limb. People with organs removed from their bodies will have new organs placed into them supernaturally. The Lord showed me in the spiritual world place where all these things were being prepared. And one of the things that the angels of God say is, not many have taken from this place. We have only very few creative miracles. But the second wave will be a wave of creative miracles. And in that time, the glory of God will be so strong, so powerful, that you not only see churches of 10,000, 20,000, or hundreds of thousands, you have churches of millions of people because of the presence of the glory of the Lord. Waves will come. And the Lord showed me how the waves are going to begin, the waves of healing. And in this first wave of healing, one of the things that the Lord said, that as you move and travel and announce to minister to the people once again, just beginning the traveling ministry, telling people about what the Lord's commission and message is, the Lord says that I have already predestined and ordained notable miracles. And those people have already been prepared, have been predestined even before they were born for a time such as this. Generation as ours with so much unbelief. Lord has already ordained notable miracles. And these notable miracles will just come forth because of the presence of the Lord. And the Lord says that these are the testimonies that you must collect and tell people about. And their faith will rise up. And so since I've been started to travel I've been commissioned to repeat this every time, especially to a new group of people, that the Lord is present here, and you could be among those. If you have a sickness or a disease, you've been declared medically impossible to heal you. You could be among those whom God has predestined, that your witness of your miracle and healing will bless thousands, if not millions, of others. So never despair about your situation or any impossible situation, for it is possible with God's presence and power. In a moment of time, in a second and split second, every disease and sickness will just be wiped away from the surface of the earth. And since that time, every time I come across people with impossible sickness and disease, I say, Lord, you know, could this be among those notable miracles? He used the word notable miracles. And I would expect that it's going to happen. It's going to flow forth as we just allow God's presence to work. Tonight, we're going to continue what we have been touching on the Holy Spirit and on the presence of God. We talk about spirit, soul, and body, and how the presence of God is in our spirit. And how do we tap into the realm of the Spirit? So let's look at the Bible in the book of Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9. And look at the Ark of the Covenant of God. In the most holy place is a piece of furniture called the Ark. Hebrews chapter 9 verse 4. It says that behind the second veil, in verse 3 and 4, behind the second veil, the part of the tabernacle which is called the holiest of all, the most holy place, verse 4, which had the golden altar of incense, and the ark of the covenant overlaid on all sides with gold, in which were the golden pot that had the manna, Aaron's rod that budded, and the tablets of the covenant. So there was the altar of this altar incense, and then beyond that is the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant was God's manifested presence to His people in the Old Covenant. Now all these are symbols for the New. Today I have seldom heard of people describing more about the ark and what it means in a new covenant. But you know how important the ark was to the old covenant? It was the only thing. You could have the whole tabernacle of Moses minus the ark and it would be meaningless. The ark was it. And in fact, when at one time they lost the ark, everyone was in a panic. Because the presence of God was there. It's the Shekinah glory of God. To lose it is to lose everything. In the ark are three things. Tells us here, you have the manna, Aaron's rod, and the tablets of the covenant. Three things in the ark. Where the presence of God is. And somewhere in the Old Covenant, when they lost the presence of God, even Ezekiel was shown how the glory of God disappeared. See, we can have the best organization, the best planning, the best intellects, the best of everything. But if you don't have the presence of God, it comes to nothing. Not to say those things are not important in their own aspects. They have their place. The soul has its place. The attributes of the soul, the intellect, the emotions, human abilities, they have a place. They just need to be in line doing what God wants. But if we don't have the presence of God, everything is of no use. And when people seek healing from the Lord, or they seek a breakthrough from the Lord, you know what they actually are looking for? Just the presence of God. Because God and His presence and breakthrough are one. It is God's presence that we need in the earth. Let me show forth in some examples in the Bible how important that presence was. That even without His people, God's presence still continued. Even in the ark, His presence protects the ark. In the book of 1 Samuel, that time the priesthood was not walking with God, Eli the priest and his sons. And God has to protect His own presence. And a terrible thing happened in 1 Samuel chapter 4. 1 Samuel chapter 4. The Philistines were causing problems to God's people. And in the battle, we are told in 1 Samuel chapter 4, that in the battle, as the Israelites were being defeated, in verse 3, the people had come into the camps. The elders of Israel say, "Why has the Lord defeated us today before the Philistines? Let us bring the ark." And the ark was a magic formula. "Let us bring the ark of the covenant." After all, the ark has looked after them for all those years. And when the ark of the covenant of the Lord came to the camp, the people followed accordingly. But here's the problem. The presence of God was still in the ark. The ark still had that anointing of God. But the people's life were not in line. It was like, as I shared this morning, it's like your body and your soul is not in line with the Spirit. And here the people of God wanted to have the presence of God work for them, but their lives were not in line with God. So they try to use a magic formula. The ark is our lucky charm. And the priest at that time was not a very good priest. By the way, he was also overweight. Not looking at anyone here, so. And Eli was, in fact, Eli had a reputation as one of the fattest priests in the Bible. I don't know who is winning the prize of the fattest pastor in town. Certainly not you. Praise the Lord. And so you have here the priest allowing all these things to happen. And here comes the ark. And look at how excited the people were. So excited in 1 Samuel chapter 4. When the ark came, and you know who brought the ark? The two sons of Eli. Eli was not a very good guy. In fact, God rebuked him several times. Hophni and Phinehas, they were sinners. Sinful people. Their lives were not in line with God. And here's a magic formula. The ark. And they were carrying the ark. And as Phinehas and Hophni brought the ark where the covenant of God, the ark of the covenant of God in verse 5, when the ark of the covenant of the Lord came into the camp, all Israel shouted so loudly. I don't know what they shout. Most possibly, "Hallelujah!" But it was so loud that it would have put every Pentecostal in town to shame. They shouted so loud that the whole earth shook. Outwardly, you would have thought there's a revival happening in the camp. It was not a revival. It was just soul excitement. No matter how much you shout, it will not make the demon go away. You know, some people, when they cast out demons, they think the louder they scream, the faster the demons go. Doesn't work that way. Or the louder you shout over the sickness, the more frightened the sickness and the germs and the bacteria are. And they quickly leave the body. It's not all those things. Now, there's nothing wrong with shouting, nothing wrong with clapping, nothing wrong with rejoicing. There's a place in the Bible for those things. Because remember, there was another different shout that they did, and the walls of Jericho came down. So the problem was not in the shouting. The problem was the shouting without the Spirit. So we don't want to go to the other extreme, which sometimes people do. Human beings swing to extreme. And they say, no shouting in church. No this in church, no that in church. You know, people don't feel free anymore. So what kind of church you want to build? You want to build a shouting church? Put out a sign, this is a shouting church. And then they build a quiet church. You say, oh, we're so used to, you know. And remember those days before the charismatic move, when nobody lifted up their hands. Church was so quiet, you wonder whether you are in a cemetery. Or you're, is the person next to you alive? So, it'll be a quiet church. No, you got to flow with the Spirit of God. And human expressions, emotion, there's nothing wrong with that. We are just what we are. But it's when we pretend to be what we are not. It's when we become artificial. That's where it becomes wrong. So, when the Holy Spirit of God moves, I say tonight, as you begin to do everything, whatever He wants to do in your life, if your nature or the way they touch you and you flow, it's just a part of you, that's fine. But when it's not a part of you, and you're trying to use those things to bring the presence of God, it's exactly like what Eli and Hophni and Phinehas tried to do. I don't care if the earth shakes. I don't care if the whole building shakes. In here, the whole earth shook. In fact, the enemy was very frightened. The enemy was so frightened that this is what they said, the Philistines, in verse 6. When the Philistines heard the noise of the shout, they said, what does the sound of this great shout in the camp of the Hebrews mean? See, what's all the commotion? There's a revival out there. It's not really a revival. It's a fleshly excitement. The thing about Christians is they don't differentiate between fleshly excitement and a spiritual revival. Because spiritual revival can produce fleshly shouting, or spiritual revival can result in normal emotional flow and outbursts of expression, which is fine. But the opposite is not true. The fleshly emotions never produce the spirituality. And look at what happens to them when they discovered, they understood that the ark, oh, that brings fear to people. When the ark of the Lord had come into the camp, they were frightened to their wits. Out of their wits, rather. So in verse 7, the Philistines were afraid. Look at what he was doing to them. And sometimes in a revival, you have a mixture of spirit and soul. And sincere people come, they get blessed, they go. But at other times, people who expect some things, and they're not really in the spirit, and they got all kinds of reaction. It might even look like Philistines being frightened and the bad guys being driven away. You know, it's more the overall mercy and faith of God. God works in spite rather than because. Because God wants to bless His people so much. And so the Philistines were afraid, and they said, God, even they were saying, God has come to the camp. Not their camp, the enemy's camp. See, they recognized the history of the ark, and they were frightened. And look at what they say in verse 7. Woe to us. In I don't know how the expression here, but in Asia they say, die, die, die. Say, silo, silo. Say, or whatever word they use. We are dead, finished. Gone, kaput, habis. Finished, we are dead. So, woe to us. Such a thing has never happened before. Woe to us, in verse 8. Second time they did it. Who will deliver us from these mighty gods? These are the gods who struck the Egyptians and all the plagues in the wilderness. So they told themselves, since we're going to die, let's fight. Let's die fighting. And they said, be strong, conduct yourselves like men, and so that you don't become a servant of the Hebrews, let's fight. They fought. Surprise, surprise, they won. It says 30,000 foot soldiers died. The ark was captured. And the Israelites were now in a panic. And news got back to Eli. Says, the ark is gone. Eli heard it, had a stroke, fell down, and in physics we say the weight of his body was so great it broke his neck. He died on the spot. Suddenly Israel was in a panic. Look, no more ark. The ark is gone. And indeed, the ark was taken. And for a while, the Israelites didn't know what to do. They lost the most precious possession of all the revelation God gave them. The Bible tells us here in verse chapter 4, that when the ark was taken away, and somebody gave birth and they gave a wrong name, called the poor child Ichabod. Don't any one of you do that. Ichabod means the glory is gone. Poor child living out with that name. Right? Hi, glory has gone. Come here. Glory has gone. Come here. Bad man. And so you have in chapter 5, the Philistines took the ark in verse 2 to the temple of Dagon. And as they put it like a trophy, in verse 3, the next morning they found Dagon bowed down before the ark. See, God protected himself. It's just the presence of God. And they got into all kinds of problems. And they put everything back together again. Next morning, Dagon fell down before the ark. Even the dumb idols worshipped the ark. Because the presence of God is there. God protected himself. See, it's the presence of God that is important. The presence of God that is needed. Not just all the side effects. And as they got into that situation, they finally consulted and said, look, this is, look, we're having plagues, we're having all these things. And in the end, they had to send the ark back. They couldn't, imagine, the Philistines couldn't hold the ark. Because when they consulted one another, they said, look, if we keep the ark here, not a single one of us will be alive. We all die. Because it's not meant to be here. Such is the presence of God. And he went back to the Israelites. God protected him. When no one could fight for God, God's presence fought for himself. Without any, when all the Israelites were so disobedient, not a single one of them was in tune with God. God's presence resolved himself. And they had to let the ark go, and it came all the way back to Israel. See, the presence of God has a certain place, and it's meant to be where it's meant to be. And this afternoon, this morning, we saw the presence of God is in our spirit. Our spirit, soul, and body, and God dwells in our spirit. The presence of God is in our spirit. The presence of God is there to heal. Sometimes you read in the book of, in the Gospels. It's the presence of God. If you take away the presence of God from all the church, we have nothing left. Only ceremony. It's the presence of God. Now what about the Christian life? You take away the presence of God, we have nothing left. But what is this presence? What's so special about this presence? This presence, the ark, where is the ark? I'm not talking about the physical ark now. We all understand that the Old Testament physical ark, that's a different story, a shadow. But where is the ark now? We have the new covenant. Where is our ark? We know our ark is Jesus, the glory of God. And Jesus is in our spirit. And here's the question. If the presence of God in the ark is so powerful, how come the presence of God in individual Christians, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, why is it not demonstrating so much power? It was so powerful, the presence protected itself. So what every Christian needs is not just more teaching. Teaching is good. You know what the good teaching does? The good teaching brings you to understand more about the presence of God. And what every Christian needs is not more principles. Principles are good. But the real good principles lead you more into the presence of God. The whole key to Christianity is the presence of God. And the presence of God is supposed to be in our spirit. How do we tap on this presence? We read in Hebrews chapter 9 that the presence of God, where the ark is, contained three little pieces of furniture. Inside the ark, the furniture contained three little pieces. The tablet of Moses, the rod of Aaron, which was also the rod of Moses, and the pot of manna. That came all the way from the time when God supplied manna to them in the wilderness. Now, if you study any Christian book about spirit, soul, and body, they tell you that the body consists of your will, your emotions, and your mind, which we touched on that this morning. And then when they talk about your spirit, they say that your spirit has three areas: your conscience, your intuition, and communion. What do those things mean? How do those things tie to this? So I'm going to reclassify that. You read Watchman Nee on the spiritual man, he will talk about those things. But he didn't tie it to the ark. We're going to tie it to the ark, since the ark represents where God's presence lives inside. The ark is Jesus today. Jesus is our ark of a covenant. He lives in our spirit. How do those things in the ark tie to it? The first piece that is very easy to tie is the tablet of Moses. Because the tablet of Moses is the law, and the law tells you what is right and wrong. And in our spirit, there is a part of us that tells you right and wrong, called your conscience. So the tablet of Moses represents your conscience, tells you right and wrong. Now we need to flow. If you want to flow with the spirit, you must flow with the conscience. Otherwise, it's like taking the part of the ark. Remember, the ark contained those things. It will be like taking one third of it and throwing out. Let me show in the Bible here, in Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, where Paul says he served God with his spirit. It's very important that we flow, when we walk with God, we flow with our conscience. In Romans chapter 1, verse 9, the passage that we read this morning, "For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayer." So he's serving God with his spirit. So remember, the spirit has three components. And the three components of his spirit that he must listen to all the time, look over at the book of Timothy. And he has an illustration there in Timothy. 1 Timothy. As he writes to these people and exhort them about walking in walking in faith them, before them. He tells us this, read this portion here, 1 Timothy 1 verse 5 first. Now the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience, and from sincere faith. Now all those parts are important. In the service of God, you would need a good conscience. For without conscience, you would be hindering the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. And the Holy Spirit is like one third of your spirit not functioning properly. It's important to serve God with our conscience, flowing along with Him, and letting your conscience tell you what is right and what is wrong. And in Romans 14 and other passages, he talks about how each person's conscience are at different levels. He talks about some people who worship God in one day, choose one day, some worship God every day, some eat vegetables, some eat meat, and talking about all the various things. Each person has their conscience. Apparently, the conscience got different levels. There's a basic conscience of the major commandments of right and wrong, but there are a lot of little tiny decisions. And he even tells them in Romans 14, he says, don't force someone to go beyond what their conscience is troubling them. He says, flow with them. And he did call them, he says, they may be weaker, but you must not make the weaker stumble. So the conscience is not just a major area of right and wrong in a big area. It's the tiny little things that make sure that everyone is walking according to their level of faith. And if you move outside of your conscience, you're taking one third of your spirit off. We have to flow with our level of faith and our level of conscience, or what we sense to be right and wrong deep within us. Your conscience must be in harmony in order to flow with the work of the Spirit. The other area is the rod of Moses. The rod of Moses, or rod of Aaron, because Aaron was carrying Moses' original rod and using it after he protested that he couldn't speak well. So Aaron became his spokesman. So the original rod that Moses had turned into the snake, it became Aaron's rod that Aaron kept using. That was the same rod of Moses that was placed in the Ark of the Covenant. What does that rod represent in the New Testament, in our spirit? Should be easy for you. Anybody want to venture a guess? Yes. Uplifting, yes. Getting closer, warmer. Was there a hand up just now? I just want to hear the key word, yes. Eh? Spoken word, yes. Getting warmer. Authority, yes. Getting very warm. Yes. Glory, yes. Very, very warm. Still haven't get the power, yes. Very, 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 very warm. Still waiting for a word. Leadership, yes, yes. Ah, thank you. That was our whole topic. The anointing. The anointing shall break the yoke. It was the anointing of God on Moses. That rod represents His anointing. Because, and everything that you said just now, this was good, because the anointing brings power. The anointing brings authority. The anointing brings everything else. If someone is anointed by God and walks in, he has authority. See, all those things you said are good. Leadership, yes, the anointing makes a leader what a leader is. It's the anointing. The anointing that was on Moses, represented by that rod. And remember, That anointing is so important that even Moses has to learn how to use that anointing. And there was one time when he was using, the rod was like the way he released the anointing. Here's the interesting thing about the rod. Many things about, we could teach a whole 3-part sermon on the rod. The rod of Moses. The rod, then get a rod here. Okay. Well, these are all attached tonight, but I can use that. Okay. Oh, we got another rod here. Okay. So, the rod of Moses symbolizes a particular style in which God worked in his life. See, we're talking about the Spirit and the anointing of God. Some people, their anointing is on their spoken word. So, they work powerfully through a spoken word. Some people, their anointing is in their hands. So, they will always have to lay hands. And you remember that Jesus understands how to work at different levels of anointing. This is in the Bible in Mark chapter 6. When he went to his hometown, and the people didn't believe that the anointing was upon him. They had a lot of unbelief. They couldn't believe that the anointing was on him. It says he could not do mighty works. Except he lay hands. You see, if they could raise their faith level higher, he could just spoken the word and they would have got what they want. And remember in the Bible there was such a story too, the centurion who came to him, and Jesus said, I will come and heal your servant. And the centurion says, no, you don't have to come. Because I'm a commander, if I command my soldier do this, he do that, you have authority over sickness, you just speak, and my servant will be healed. So when he believed the anointing of Jesus was in his spoken word, that could travel and heal his servant without Jesus laying hands, he got what he wanted. But the people in Mark chapter 6 could not believe Jesus had the anointing on him. When Jesus came to the hometown, they said, who is this? He's just a carpenter. Straight away, he dropped down. Who is this? We know his sisters. We know his brothers. Who does he think he is? And Jesus had to, his anointing was just reduced to laying hands. Because the anointing, in the minimum, and this is the interesting thing about Jesus. Do you notice that in the worst case scenario, where it's difficult to minister. Let's say I pick some of you up, send you as missionaries to Timbuktu or somewhere. People, you know, all anti, right? They might not be there, but just illustrating. And your difficult time, even to preach, difficult, you always reduce to laying hands. Always. Because in the worst case scenario, the anointing still can flow through the impartation or laying on of hands. It's a whole doctrine in itself. The Bible calls it a foundational doctrine about laying on of hands. Imparted through the hands. So Jesus did that. He laid hands. And there are different types of anointing that flow. With Elijah, it was his mantle. His mantle was the key. When the mantle was there, anointing was there. You just pray, God, that when anointing works in your life, that your special anointing won't be on your toes. Very hard to lay toes on the sick and they recover. People have to understand what the anointing is in their life. And there are three areas of anointing and spirit work. There are different administrations, there are different diversities of gifts, and there are different manifestations. And administrations means that it's how God chooses to work in each person's life. And some people are stronger in functioning in certain anointing than others, and we can grow in anointing. Instead of being limited, we could grow in anointing, as we so desire. So for Moses, the rod of Moses was the key. Everything revolved around that rod. He has seen the power that is inherent. Now that rod was converted from his old rod. I mean, he had been using the rod for 40 years before he met God. And suddenly God put all the power in the rod. And when he threw the rod down, it turned into a snake and all kinds of things. And when he did all the 10 different plagues, it was his rod. He actually didn't do it. He asked Aaron to do it because Aaron was his spokesman. And so Aaron would raise it up for him, the rod of Moses. And you remember in Exodus chapter 17 when they were fighting, and he learned to use that anointing. When Joshua had to fight the Amalekites, and Moses stood on the mountain and he lifted his rod up. He lifted his hand, but his hand contained a rod. Because that was the anointing that he was lifting up. And the Bible tells us that every time his hand got tired, started coming down, Joshua lose. Every time his hands went up, Joshua was winning. It's in the Bible, by the way, that story. It sounds like a cartoon story, but it's real. Better turn to it in the Bible so some of you know that it's very real. Exodus chapter 17, in verse 8 to verse 16, is where you find that story. Joshua was fighting Amalekites. Moses was there. Aaron and Hur were with him. And Moses' hand got tired sometimes, you know. How long can you hold up your hands? And the battle is there. And Joshua doesn't know anything. He was not holding the rod. He was holding the sword. So Joshua was a soldier. He was fighting, you know. He goes. And he cannot be watching Moses and fighting here. Right? What do you think he is? A one-armed swordsman or what? No, he was busy fighting. And as he's busy fighting, you know, for some reason, you know, Moses up there, his hand got tired, coming down, he's chasing the enemy. Suddenly his enemy got more strength. And he could have been, where Moses? So poor Joshua sometimes. So what happened if Moses put his hand this way, this way, this way, this way, this way, this way? Poor Joshua. And then he goes up again. And then goes back again. Goes up again. Right. It's a real cartoon story. Thank God that in that situation, it must have happened a few times, by the way, before they notice it. Must have happened a few times because Aaron and Hur quickly raised Moses' hands up. And Moses was tired, at least somebody is holding up his hand. You know. And they had to hold his hand up the whole day. Until Joshua won. What was the significance? The anointing of God. They were fighting not based on their own self, their own strength. Now, let me ask this question. What pugilistic skill was different? Nothing. Was it because it's the style of Joshua's fighting before he was fighting like a Frenchman? Then he started winning. Then when he tried the samurai style, started losing. Was it his fighting style that made the difference? No. Was it his muscles? No. It was the same set of muscles. Nothing to do with Joshua. Everything to do with Moses up there. What was the connection? The anointing of God. The same with David. You know, before he went to battle, he understood that David was quite a warrior and fighter. As you know, he fought Goliath. But when he was leading an army, what was important to David was the presence of God. You read about it in his early days as he started conquering for Israel. He would wait till he hear the sound of a rustling over the leaves. Then he know God's presence is here. See, he was a man not just skillful in fighting. He says, it's God who trains my hands to fight. Not his own pugilistic skill. It was God who did it. So he was relying on the presence of God to bring him through. So David, before he fight a battle, he would consult God. God, what do you say? Because he wanted God to be on his side. God to fight with him. God told Joshua too. He says, the armies you're fighting are better than you. You're tiny, little, but because I am with you, makes a difference. And so David would learn the skill of waiting the presence of God come, and then he charged. When he heard a rustling of the leaves, oh, that is David's anointing. You see, everyone must recognize your anointing. David's anointing is fighting with the sword and the rustling of leaves. But if your anointing is not the sword and the rustling of leaves, and you hear the rustling of leaves and you try to move, all you get are autumn leaves. Nothing else. Because that was the way David operated his anointing. The way Moses operated his anointing was holding up the rod. But every one of us must learn to operate on the anointing that you already have. If you're not willing to operate on it, it will never grow, it will never be stronger, and you will never cross the Red Sea. That's the story that I wanted to point to you. As they stood, you know how Moses learned in Exodus 17 about the power of the rod? The crossing of the Red Sea. There was one lesson that was imaged into his memory that he knew now what to do. Every time he had a difficult moment, he knew now what to do. In Exodus chapter 14. This famous story of crossing the Red Sea, we know the Egyptians on one side, the mountains on one side, the sea on one side. And in Exodus 14, it tells us that as they came before the sea, verse 13, Exodus 14 verse 13. Here is where he learned about the rod and using it to fight battles. In verse 13, Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." Now stop there for a while. He had faith. He was expecting God to work. He was expecting God to work. But God was expecting him to use his anointing that he had already given. See, sometimes people expect God to work. They do all that they need to do, but they forgot to use the anointing that God had already answered the prayer. When God answered the prayer, it is not just him working, it's him working through you. So if you've been praying, for example, for church growth, and you're waiting, you know, God also is waiting. You prayed, you fasted, you believe. You really believe. Did Moses believe? Yes. Did Moses have faith in God? Yes. But Moses was still waiting. And God also is waiting. So you pray for something, sometimes you say, "I'll wait on God." That's good. There's a time and place for waiting on God. But sometimes you're waiting on God's time has finished because he actually answered. See, how do I know? Because he answered in the Spirit. He gave you something in the Spirit. You're supposed to take what you have in the Spirit, relate it to your soul, and function with your body. And you're waiting, and you couldn't hear God, and you're still waiting, but God is also waiting. And if you're to try to play a waiting game with God, I tell you, don't try. He lives very long. He will outlive you. God is eternal. You could wait 10 years and God is also waiting. Time is irrelevant to him, but it's relevant to us. Has God answered your prayers? Sometimes he has. Now, how do I know? And I hope to touch on that tomorrow night or tomorrow morning. But how you know when your spirit has received it? There's something that you can detect. But that's not for tonight. As usual, you know, say, come the next day. But that's because we've got some other important things to cover, right? And for additional tapes, no, whatever. So, okay. What we want, here Moses is waiting on God, and God is already told him, I already taught you, I already shown you, you have been successful so many times. And God says to Moses in verse 15, why do you cry to me? Why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. But he says, but lift up your rod. So Moses learned. Rely on the anointing that God has given him. See, he was waiting for God to do something. God was waiting for him to do something. And that's what happens sometimes when people pray and they believe God and they miss one part. Just one part. That God has answered in the spirit, but they didn't act it out. You know, Kenneth Hagin, who is gone to be with the Lord, he was given up to die. You read his biography in I Believe in Visions. And as he believed God for his healing, and he lived a long time after he was healed. If you read his biography and read other books that he read which touch on that occasion of how he got his healing, and you put it all together, you notice that when he believed that he was healed, he was surrounded by people who was trying to tell him, you know, just die. But if you read his other sections of his book, how he struggled, he says, in the end, he didn't feel anything. But he felt that if he believed he was healed, he has to behave as if he was healed. And he didn't feel anything yet. But something must have clicked in his spirit. You see, when your spirit receives, your soul might not know fully, or your body might not know. It takes time, the process to go through. But of course, don't act if you really didn't have something in the spirit. That would be disastrous. You don't, you know, say, oh, this is what God says, and then you run to the hospital, you know, pull everyone out. And there's a person in a wheelchair pulling out. Come on, Jesus say you're healed. Huh? Instead of hospital ministry, your next ministry is prison ministry. That's where you end up. Kill all the people, die. People don't have faith. You know. Yeah, in ICU, you know. Half dead. You pull out all their tubes. Come on, walk. You try to be a Wigglesworth. Put them on the wall, you know. Walk, come on. You know. If they didn't walk, they fall down on their face and die. Because you haven't got it in the spirit yet. They haven't got it in the spirit yet. Nobody got it in the spirit yet. And your body is trying to do something. Remember what I said just now? The presence of God has not come yet. It's not there. And all your shouting shake the earth, but you still lose the ark. You got to discern. Although we talk about spirit, soul, and body, you have to discern that your spirit really has got it. And there's a way to tell that your spirit has got it. There is definitely a way. Praise God. There is a way. Tomorrow night, remember, right? And tomorrow night, I might tell you the next session. No, I won't. Okay. So, we have here the rod of Moses, and God says, Moses, raise your rod up. And when Moses lifted it up, the winds blew a whole night. And some people forgot how long he has to hold it up. See, that is where he learned the skill of holding the rod up. Some people think it's easy to operate the anointing. Go, oh, anointing comes, it just comes. Yes, it does, but there is also some work involved from the obedient side. In Exodus 14, he lifted up his rod, and it tells us what happened in between in verse 21. Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, so he used his rod to stretch over the sea. And the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all the night. All the night. So some people in the movies that they show, you know, so stylish. Moses go, And the Red Sea parted, zoom, within a few seconds. And all of them go, hallelujah, and they went right through. Why? Because their movie is 1.5 hour long. They cannot make a movie when Moses is just... The real story is Moses. You can call him poor Moses, but he's okay. He has to be holding it all night. And everyone around him sleeping. And the wind was blowing. The whole night. Say, what about the Egyptians? That's all right, because God was holding them back. But the whole night. It was not overnight prayer. It was not overnight singing. It was overnight holding the rod up. The whole night he was holding the rod up, the anointing of God. Let me tell you, sometimes you have to believe in the anointing on your life. You got to keep exercising it. And as he holds up the whole night, non-stop rod holding. The next morning, everyone saw a clear path. I don't know how many people came to Moses and said, "Thank you, Moses." And then he went right through. And I always like this part of the story, which I always tell. You know, people tell you that the sea was so shallow and all those things. You all know the story about, you know, all these people drowning. I say, well, the Bible tells us that the sea was a wall on one side and a wall on the other. As they walked, there was two walls of water with nothing holding it up. Who knows, you know? On that day, it could be a fish who was swimming right through. Moses and his rod, the fish was stuck. I don't know how many fishes got stuck along the way. I'm sure the angels are very, very careful. So I can imagine the little kid said, "Hey, Mom, dinner." And the parents said, "Don't pull, don't pull." Poor Moses, holding the rod up whole night. Because the anointing needs to be exercised in God. What does that rod represent in the New Testament? 1 John 2:27. The anointing within you. The anointing within you teach you all things. So there is an anointing, an unction in the old translation, within you. So the anointing upon has to move with the anointing within. And as you flow with the anointing of God, sometimes the anointing of God, will stir you. And you know that's what you must do. That's the way you have to flow. So if the gift of the Spirit is working in your life and you don't exercise those gifts, it remains dormant. Like the rod of Moses not being used. Later on, you see Moses using the rod even as if God was not instructing him, because he knew how to handle the anointing now. Thank you very much. And that's the rod of Moses, the anointing of God that flows through in his life. And the anointing is within each one of us. Every one of us who is born again, our spirit has a measure of the Spirit, the anointing within. And every one of us have another third component, which is the manna. The bottle that or little container that contains the manna. Now, the manna was so interesting that if they had kept it in their own home and overnight, it would have rotted. But when that manna was kept in the ark, the presence of God preserved it and it never went off. What is that manna? That manna represents, in the Old Testament, food, physical food. In the New Testament, it represents the eternal Zoe life of God that is inside our spirit. When the Bible says that if you believe in Jesus and you have eternal life, it's not talking about a life to come. It includes that. It's talking that right now that eternal life comes into you. But the life is qualified as an eternal life because it's a life that never dies. It's a life, it's the life of God. He uses a special Greek word, Zoe life. The life that is the same life of God, the same life of Christ. Now it's inside our spirit. Eucharistio. And how that process works is to learn to draw on the Spirit of God and the anointing from within. Now, we all have received Christ. We all have a measure of grace in our life. Salvation grace, we call it. And as we bring ourselves unto God to draw on, where is the throne of grace? Through our spirit we access it. God is spirit and we access through the spirit. And as we draw onto the throne of grace to draw grace, the procedure is grace upon grace. Thanksgiving, Eucharistio, where you have a good added to grace and making it into a verb. That's a concept that we're hard to translate over. But it means that somehow the grace that you have received, you see, grace builds grace. The grace that we receive helps you to access more grace. It's like when you open a bank account and all the money is in the bank and you go to the ATM. Your ATM card may have a limit of 1,000 a day or whatever, and you may have 100,000 inside. You can access it a part of the time. It doesn't mean that you're using it, and I know it depends on the limits inside your account. But there's also each time that you come, you draw on. Many people forget that when Christ came, He gave us the grace to approach Him. In Romans 5, therefore, being justified by faith, we have grace and peace with God, wherein we stand. And that is to enable us to enter in. But it's not just charis with charis, it's Eucharistio with charis, which means the grace that we have received in our lives would change us. It becomes, you means good. Good grace that brings us to a habit of thanksgiving. That is why the Bible says, in everything, give thanks. It is not just for the sake of giving thanks. It's because it's the key to tapping on the Spirit within you and the throne of grace. Now, Eucharistio is an inner attitude where it operates on your soul as well as in your spirit. So Eucharistio is where your soul is now tuned to the spirit and it understands how to access that spirit within you, the energy of God within you. And by thanksgiving in God, you draw grace. And in every situation, you draw more grace. And you draw more grace. Therefore, grace upon grace. That is how you get the expression, grace upon grace. What about the expression, faith upon faith, glory upon glory? It means you already have the glory. You have another layer of glory. Faith upon faith, you already have faith. You got another layer of faith. Grace upon grace, you have grace. You got another layer of grace. As you know, grace has adjectives in the New Testament. Grace can be increased, can be multiplied. Grace can grow. So, somehow the measure of grace that we receive brings our soul and our mind into an attitude of thanksgiving. Where you know that God is a good God. It has to be you, charis, good grace. And if you believe that God is a good God, it helps. If the devil convinces you that God is a bad God, which is what he convinced Adam and Eve. Oh, you know, God is not good to you. He doesn't want you to do this and that. He doesn't want you to have this and that. He's a bad God, in other words, he's saying. And think about what the world's image of God is. Big man upstairs with stick. That's your image of God. They don't know that God is love. That God is spirit. So how can you on one hand think he's bad and still come to him? Something in you will start withdrawing from him. Good grace. You understand the goodness of God. Like David, he understands that God is good to him. Even though he's a naughty boy. If God is good, he might not be so good. Still comes to God. Draws on the grace of God. In thanksgiving, the altar incense, what does it represent? Thanksgiving, praise, and worship. That is why in every one of our lives, if we release thanksgiving, praise, and worship, you will always sense an increase in your life. So many people, they're praying for this, praying for that, but you check their thanksgiving level, it's almost zero. Then you know it's not going to work. Because it's their soul without the you inside. You carry good grace. And you check people who say, you know, name it, claim it, I believe it. Don't just look at their confidence. Don't just look at how confident they are or how much word they have. Look at how much thanksgiving they have. Because that is the area where grace has succeeded in working in their life. And if we become ungrateful, Romans 1, what happened to those people? They were ungrateful. They were not thankful. So they cut themselves off from God. That's why the Bible says in the New Testament, we know who God is. God so loved. It's a revelation of God's love. It's a revelation of how much God loves us. And if God really loves us, then you will be thanking him, praising him. And you would be like Moses lifting the anointing of God in thanksgiving unto him, in praise and worship unto him. And the New Testament has so many ways to release that. In Psalms 141, you find a phrase there that the lifting up of my hands is as the evening sacrifice. You know how difficult it was to do the evening sacrifice? A lot of work. But it's been reduced to the lifting up of our hands in the new covenant. Psalms 119, verse 164. David says, 7 times a day will I praise him. There's something about thanksgiving and praise every day. Not just in the morning. Continually. How often? Where? In everything. And you notice the times in your life when you felt less presence of God is when you are less thanksgiving and grateful. Because it's cutting you from the Spirit. And the more you give thanks to God, the more you keep that channel open. For all the energy of the Spirit to come true in your life. I know some of you might have been praying for some things for a long time. And you might even have gone to a stage where, by faith I give thanks. Not good enough. You must really give thanks because you love Him. Eucharistio. Not just, you know, with your mind you give thanks. Where the grace in your life has touched you so much that the revelation of God in your life, you know that God loves you. You know, of the 12 disciples of Jesus, only one of them called himself the disciple whom Jesus loved. And you think, what's so special about him? Is it because Jesus treat all the disciples differently? I don't think so. You can never blame it on Jesus. It's because only John was comfortable enough to come to Jesus, because he knows Jesus will never reject him. The others didn't develop their confidence. John was not the only one who was supposed to call himself the disciple whom Jesus loved. Jesus loved every one of his disciples. But only one of his disciples was confident in his love. And he loved Jesus back. He was so comfortable with Jesus that he almost looked sacrilegious for some. Let's say if Jesus appeared, you know, to some people may say, oh, Jesus, you know, and don't dare to go near him. Who made that rule? You did. Some people say, oh, Jesus. Why all the different reactions? Because of our own inward fear, not because of Jesus. And when Jesus was on the earth walking along the shores of Galilee, John was a different breed altogether. John would say, oh, Jesus, and just come to Jesus straight away. He was not shy or withdrawn. He knew Jesus always accepts him. He knew that he could share everything with Jesus. You and I have the access to the throne of God. You must have that confidence that God is good. In your situation, God is a good God. In whatever situation, God will know how to work all things for good to those who love him and are called according to his purpose. 7 times a day, David says, I will praise him. So it was a 7 times a day. Paul, how often is it? In everything. And when you develop the habit of saying, thank you, God, I praise you and I worship you, and really have it coming from your heart, you're always drawing upon the grace of God and the strength of God in your life for the anointing of God to work in you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you, Father God, for your love. Let's all rise together, and I'd like you all to do one thing for me. Lift up your hands in your own way and give God thanks. Give God thanks in your life in your own way. And give thanks to God for some of the things that you find it hard to give thanks, God. Because you feel there's the devil doing or your own mistakes or other. I didn't say to thank God necessarily for those things, because God never did those things. But in everything, in the situation, you still are able to give thanks to God. And you give thanks to God for your difficult situation. You give thanks to God in all your areas that you find it hard to give thanks to God. Let's give thanks to God, because He is a good God. He cares for us. He loves us. We thank you, Father. We lift our hands to you in praise and worship and thanksgiving, Lord. We thank you for all the work of your Spirit in each bunch of us. We thank you, Father, for your great mercy. We thank you, Father, for the desires of each one of us. We thank you. We thank you for the times of God that are difficult in our lives. Thank God for the valleys. Thank God for the mountains. Thank God for the troubles. Thank God for all the situations. Because when you give them to God, you must be able to thank God and see God as a good God in those situations, bringing you forth out of all those things. We thank you, Father. We praise you. We worship you, Lord. Lord, we give thanks to you. We praise you. There is a sister here, your sister towards my right side, and you have a child that is rebellious. And you just find it so hard to thank God in that situation. But your failure to thank God has caused the situations to grow worse and worse. And until and unless you're able to lift up your hands to God and give thanks for all the hurts that have been caused to you by your child will never be able to turn to the Lord. You've been praying for your children to come to the Lord, but they are not coming to the Lord yet. And you wonder why. The Lord says, I cannot work unless you lift up the rod and the anointing in your life in thanksgiving so that I can work. And even right now, as we are speaking, there is a gentleman here wearing a tight striped shirt, and you're struggling with an area of ailment in your area of your heart. And you always wonder why the Lord never brought that healing that you so long for, because you have not been giving thanks to God in your situation, and God's Spirit cannot work fully in your life. Until you do so, we give you thanks, Father. We give you praise. The man with a striped shirt, heart condition, being touched and healed. We worship you, Lord. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks. The Spirit of God is being released right now. All over the place. He's able to do things. He's flowing out in the Spirit. A sister wearing a reddish colored dress with ringing on your left ear. Your ears are being touched right now. We worship you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We thank you, Father. We worship you, Rabahandi Kibiriandala, Lord. We thank you for your people. We thank you, Father God, Rabahadi Kimiriantulo. We lift up our voices in praise to you. You deserve our praise. And Lord, we praise you not just because by praising you we can get results. We praise you because we love you, Lord. And we give thanks to you because you're a good God. Not just because of what you can do. Not just because we are a little child pretending to give thanks in order to receive. We want to give thanks because you are good, O Lord. And we believe in your goodness. We believe in your wonderful, wonderful generosity to us. Tonight the Lord is releasing salvation for homes and families. Some of you have been praying for your families for salvation for a long time, for them to turn to the Lord, for them to get closer to God, to get into things of God. And tonight as you give thanks, the Lord is releasing a work in their life. You will see them coming to know the Lord. You see God work without a word spoken. They will suddenly come to the Lord. They will suddenly be interested in the Lord. Because you have started giving thanks to God. Because you have started worshiping God. His presence starts working in your home and in your family. You will see your family, your children, people you prayed for, your loved ones coming to know Him. Continue to give thanks. Release it unto Him. Don't give up. Like Moses, you must hold on. Hold on to the anointing of God that's being released. Don't just do it for a few seconds, but do it continually. And even after tonight, this is just a beginning. When you go back to your home, you must lift up your hands and give thanks to God. You must do it continually, 7 times a day. You must do it continually in your life. And if you're praying to God for a healing or breakthrough in your life, you need to do it, not just tonight here, but when you go home, throughout your house, every day, every night, because God is releasing. God is releasing a flow of His presence. His presence is what touches. His presence is what heals. We thank You, Lord. We worship You, Lord. A back problem on the second row being touched right now here. Lord, we give thanks to You. We bless You, Lord. A sister with glasses in the right section here. You have a cyst in your in the part of your body, and God is touching you right now. It's causing you problems before, but God is touching you right now, healing you. Lord, we give thanks to You. Lord, we just thank You for walking in our midst and doing Your work, O Father God. Lord, we worship You. We love You, Lord. We love You when we praise You, Jesus. As a sister named Sally, or someone who has a person named Sally, and God is touching that person and bringing the revelation to that person of salvation, and God is bringing forth that, hold fast to that. Ebati kamoli kemeri antolo mahati ki mahati kara mache kalamas. Ora masada mata basada masi kibiri amas. Ora mati itiavolo. Sister named Marcelise. And Salise, the Lord says unto you that He is your guide and He is your hope, that you must not turn aside to the left or to the right, but He will give unto you that which you have desired, aspired to. Iko Rovodi, Lord, we thank You, Jesus, we praise You. Oh, we minister to Your Spirit, O God, through Jesus. Glorify Yourself, Jesus. Walk in our midst, Lord, and reveal Yourself to each one of us, O God. Lord, ki mahati viriantala bohuri hanige mahadige viriatalamosh. We worship You, Lord. The Spirit of God is just flowing in our midst, just doing all the work that He wants to do for so long. For so long, He wants to work in your life. For so long, He's waiting for you. He's waiting for you, and you were waiting for Him. But now tonight, you know that you have got it. And you are allowing Him to work right now. The Lord rejoices. The Lord's joy is upon you. Oh, we praise You, we worship You, O God. Holy Spirit, oh, we thank You, Father. We thank You, Jesus, for Your covenant. Oh, that You release upon each one of our lives, Your grace upon grace upon grace. Let Your people draw upon Your grace and Your strength and Your energy, Lord. In this section here is a man with a knee problem on your left knee. Right now the Lord is doing a work of healing. Person with a nerve condition, it causes you to twitch on certain areas of your face. The Lord is touching you in those areas. It's a sort of nervous system problem. We thank You, Father God. Rabahatikira belongs to man. We worship You, Lord. We thank You. We praise You, Father. Lord, let Your Spirit work. Let Your angels do work. There are many things that God is doing in our midst. Just give thanks to Him. Because tonight is your night in the presence of God. It's the presence of God that's touching your life. Oh, Riki Mahara Mahati Kiberiantulumobariantiri Atalamoti Kiberiatalabas. Kiberiantulamohoti Kiberiantulumoti Kalamash. Way at the back is a man with a growth on the inner part of your body. God is touching you. Rabaja, a sister with a lump in your body. God is touching you. Olebe Kiberiatalala wearing green dress. As God touch one, He'll touch the other. As you reach out in faith to the other, all kinds of things that the Holy Spirit is doing in our midst as we give thanks to God. Thank You, Father. We praise You. We worship You, Lord. Jesus, Jesus, we glorify you. Be glorified in our midst, Lord. Be glorified. Ikabahati kibirian terobosh. Uramahati kibirian talamachakalamash. Ramali kibaraya. Elderly sister wearing a greenish yellowish kind of dress, and you have a stomach ulcer condition and your gastric problems, they go on to touch and heal you. Receive that even right now. It's his healing gift that he drops upon your life. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. Oh, we worship you, Lord. Oh, we lift our hands to you in praise, in worship. In praise and in worship, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We love you, Jesus, with all our heart, all our mind, and all our strength, Lord. I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to those of you in the congregation with unsaved loved ones, I want you to come right to the front here too to join these here. And you've been standing for them for some time. Whether you are a parent having a child you're praying for, or whether you are a spouse praying for your spouse, and you, or whatever area in the area, because tonight the Lord will release a breakthrough upon your life. And they will suddenly have a hunger for God. And they will suddenly desire the things of God in your life. We thank you, Father God. Lord, you see these standing on the behalf of those whom they love, Lord. Father, this is what your Spirit, O Lord, wants to release upon their lives tonight. O Father, lift up your hands right now tonight. As you lift up your hands, it is like the parting of the Red Sea before your loved ones, where the way is open, that God's Spirit can now work in your life. As you lift up your hands to the Lord, God opens the door. It is just like Moses lifting up the rod. It is just like Moses lifting up his rod before the Red Sea. It's like Moses lifting up the rod on the mountain at Joshua 5. All you have to do is to keep giving thanks. You don't have to do anything else, because Joshua, whose name in the New Testament is Jesus, is the same as Joshua, and Jesus will do the fighting for you. Jesus will send laborers across their path. Jesus will release that upon their life, and salvation will come upon them. Believe God. Lift up your hands to the Lord. Oh, Riki Medikara Machaka. And tonight, you are also making a covenant with God that you're going to keep lifting up your hands until they are saved. Because like Moses, you're not going to give up. You're going to live up unto the Lord continuously, because there's going to be released a power of salvation that they will come to know God. And in fact, the Lord will grant works and signs and wonders that they may know that God is real. We thank you, Father God. Even right now, Lord, release and part the Red Sea. Release it, O Lord. We thank you, Father God, that your angels go forth to the north, south, east, and west. And you release salvation, Lord. You release them to salvation. And we don't just pray for salvation, because we know they are going to be saved. We know they are going to come to know you. We also pray for their spiritual growth. We pray that they may grow in the Word. We pray that they will grow in the Spirit. We pray, O God, that they would come to be zealous for you. That they will be not only saved, but filled with the Spirit. And that they will move in the gifts of the Spirit. That they will be used by you, O God. They will be anointed by you. And that they will go forth, O God, as anointed ones by you, Lord, to do your great work, O Father. We praise you. We release that, O Father. We thank you, Father. And seal the work of healing in the lives of those who receive healing tonight, Lord. And seal the work of healing in the souls of those who receive healing in the souls of their body. And seal the work that's in the spirit of each one here, Lord. We thank you, Father God. It is done. We thank you, Father. It is done, Father God. We thank you, Lord. It's released over this life. We praise you, Father. We worship you, Lord. And we thank you, Father, that the knowledge of Christ is released upon the lives of each one of these and their loved ones, Father. Seal your work in them, Lord. And we know, Lord, in the days to come, we're going to hear of your great work in their lives, where suddenly the spiritual hunger comes upon these loved ones, oh God, and they are hot on fire for the Lord. We thank you, Father. Oh yeah, not only that, you're going to pour your revelation. You're going to send them dreams and visions, oh God. You're going to send manifestations of your Spirit. We thank you, Father God, that you release it upon these here tonight. Thank you, Father. We bless you. We worship you, Lord. In Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you. We thank you. Let's all sing one last song in thanksgiving to the Lord. I love you, Lord.